Our world is brought together by people who give, by people who choose to go the extra mile to share a smile, those that imagine new ways to give back to their communities. Rotary has brought together leaders and dreamers from the four corners of the world for over 100 years to uplift communities and set an example to the next generation of change makers. And now, Rotary International is bringing the world together at the world's greatest show, Expo 2020. We are launching the Rotary in Action podcast. Under the sponsorship of the Association of Rotary Clubs of the UAE, District 2452. Join us and share our motto of service above self.
Hello, my name is Rotaractor David Royce and I am at the Rotary Majlis of Friendship in Expo 2020. I am immensely proud to announce to you that we are launching the Rotary in Action podcast. We are sponsored by the Association of Rotary Clubs of the UAE, District 2452, and we are partnering with Expo 2020. The objective of this podcast is to bring guests who are men and women of service, who give their hands to those in need and uplift communities and are setting an example for the generations to come. I'm really excited for you to tune into this. We are expecting a lot of fantastic guests, wonderful stories of adventures all around the world. And you are going to be inspired to go ahead and find projects and change the world. Thank you so much for tuning in. Enjoy.
Hello there. My name is Rotaractor David Royce, and we are here at the Rotary in Action podcast. And we have a very special guest with us. Dr. Andreas Appelt is a German-trained and boarded consultant orthopedic surgeon, trauma surgeon, and consultant sports medicine at Al Zahra Hospital in Dubai for 9 years. He has more than 35 years of experience in conservative and operative treatment of orthopedic conditions. He has treated a wide spectrum of spinal and joint cases with minimally invasive procedures and performed arthroscopic operations of the knees, shoulders, and knee and hip replacements. Since 2002, Dr. Andreas Appelt has been visiting Ghana for free orthopedic treatment for people in need at his own cost. His team has served thousands of patients since the inception of this project, and mainly young adults and children. We are here today to learn more about your ongoing mission in Ghana, where you started, where we are at today, and the path forward. It's an honor to have you with us. Thank you so much for joining us on the Rotary in Action podcast.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your invitation, and it's very kind of you to do all these efforts. I'm here in Dubai since 9 years. I'm an orthopedic consultant, as you highlighted. And to be honest with you, to do orthopedic treatments and service here in Dubai is very, very different than to do it in Ghana. What I'm doing here is mainly to do clinics and to perform surgeries, even trauma surgeries. It's sometimes very simple cases, sometimes very complex cases here. And I'm the most of the time I was doing my orthopedic work in Germany, and I'm trained there. And starting this Ghana project, this was just coming out of nothing. So I did surgery for a Catholic bishop on his knees twice in Germany, and then he invited me to visit him in Ghana. And
this that's how it started?
Was the start up of the project. Okay. So my first visit was 2002 then in Ghana, and since that time I'm traveling very regular, you can say every year or latest every 1.5 years to the place, and then performing the surgeries. We learned a lot about these cases. So for sure, we have now our fixed plan how to treat even very severe deformities. And it was also a process for me to learn that. So I'm very thankful to have the chance to get in touch with these very difficult deformities or difficult problems on the orthopedic field. And I want to give you some examples. One important thing and problem there is the club foot or club feet problem for the children. And it is on one side very sad that we have these big, big number of club-feeted children and young adults, because it shouldn't be like that. So normally the club foot can be treated immediately after birth, very simple, just with a splinting, and that's it. But nobody takes care in these poor countries. So the club foot is starting to develop very, very bad. So we can see and learn what can happen. And if you see then, let's say, an 8 or 10 years child not able to walk because of these severe deformities, it's very sad to see that. Because if you know how simple to treat it in the very first beginning, you shouldn't expect these situations. But you have a high number of these problems. And in the beginning, I was always very optimistic. I will train the doctors there, and then they can take over and they can handle it. Unfortunately, it is not like that. So the doctors will not take care for it, and some of them know how to do it and how to treat it. But if it's then in the severe deformity, then it's difficult and they cannot handle it anymore. So we are taking, of course, a lot of these cases, and we are inviting all the local doctors to join us and to do it. But unfortunately, they will never ever take over and do it by themselves.
Is it the lack of expertise, or
it's a mix of all these? You know,
the cases are just too complicated.
Some centers that are doing even the complex deformities, but you can see in the big centers in Ghana, they are overloaded with other problems, which is the big trauma problems, you know. So you can see they can handle a limited number of cases every day, but they will have more than double of problems every day coming to the centers. So they are not able to take proper care for the elective cases. And this club foot problem is an elective case. And the second thing is, we are doing that free for charge. People are poor. They don't have any money. They are living in very, very limited resources. And if they are have the chance to change life, if we are coming and to do so, and they don't need to pay because they cannot afford to pay, then they will take this chance. So unfortunately, this bad situation for the patients and the children is also a lack of money, a lack of resources. It's not only a lack of expertise of the doctors. So I don't want to blame any local doctor, and I know how difficult it is. I have also a bit experience building a group of doctors. So I remember a couple of trips. I had very, very famous orthopedic experts with me in the group, big university professors in Germany. And at the end, they couldn't handle these cases because they never saw that before in their life. The cases in Europe, as well here in Dubai, are very difficult and different to the cases in Ghana. So this is something you need to have specific training on that. So what are our cases? I told you about the club feet. We have the deformities of the legs, deformities on the upper limbs, like arms and hands. We have a lot of infection problems, bone infection. It's called osteomyelitis. This is a real, real big problem, because it's not done with some antibiotics. You need to do sometimes very, very big surgeries, maybe you need to do then revision surgeries, a lot of them, to get the infection eradicated. And if you give only antibiotics, what in some cases the doctors did, you will perform more problems because you will create then resistance on the bacteria and you're not able then to eradicate the problem. And it's not only that the bone is infected and we have some leakage of pus, it's also that they will become septic. That means there is a general infection in the body, and this can be life-threatening. So this is a huge problem as well. And finally, we have also some malunions of bones that after trauma, it was not proper healed or non-healed. And this is also something you will never see it here, because here everybody has the chance to get proper treatment for his trauma. And there, sometimes they cannot afford, and or they came to the wrong place, and finally something was not healing well, and we have to correct it then later on. But for me, it's we are doctors, or I'm a doctor. So to become a doctor means you want to have people. You have a humanitarian spirit, and this is our main target in life, to help people and to treat problems. And this is something you can do it very good in Ghana, and you have the everyday feeling, okay, you are doing something good, and it helps. But we have to do this respectful, even to limit what we are doing. And sometimes we have to tell even the poor patients, no, sorry, we cannot do it. If I have the feeling, yes, I can do it here in Dubai, it doesn't mean I can do it there in Ghana. For example, if you have young people with severe problems on the hips or on the knees, there are problems even for very young people with avascular necrosis on these joints. And then they develop destroyed hip and destroyed knee joints. This is a big problem, and you can treat it only with a hip or knee replacement.
Do you have a team with you that, you told us that you did this in 2002, but since then, have you built up a team that you take to Ghana with you? And how does this operation work?
That's a very good point. So first of all, the first trip was only, I was alone. I was on my own, and I didn't have any orthopedic hospital there or a fixed unit where I can go. So I visit existing hospitals, and I did the surgeries previously there on these hospitals. And by time for each visit, somebody joined me. So you can see, in average, we have to build a team from minimum 3 or 4 persons, and not all of them are doctors. So it's even not necessary to have all the time very well educated doctors. It's also very helpful if non-doctors are coming and joining to organize things around, and even to make photos or to do a triage and organize even simple things. You know, what I have to highlight is we need to understand that the trips to Ghana, this is always about a period of, let's say, 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So all what you are performing, you need to do it in a way that after that trip, everything is ongoing.
Yeah.
And this is one big difference. So here you will have proper follow-ups with the patients, and you can do then some physiotherapy, some rehabilitation program, which is very, very different there. So you need to achieve a success if you do a protocol or if you do the surgery there. And now you will ask me for sure, do you have also doctors there in Ghana helping and supporting? And the answer is yes and no. So since the last 5 years, we have a fixed orthopedic unit. And since that time, we are able to come all the time to the same place and do the surgeries there.
So how many patients do you think you have to say no to because of the lack of infrastructure at the moment?
Yeah, you can say out of three, you do the surgery for one. So if you see three patients, you can perform one out of the three for surgery, and the other two, either he doesn't need a surgery or we cannot do it because my feeling is we will harm the patient more if we do it because of the conditions there, or we don't have the proper equipment. So this is the problem in the moment. So we cannot do all what we would like to do, but we can do a lot. And the other side is not all is very expensive. For example, to treat a small child, let's say 1 year for the clubfoot, this is cheap. This is a cheap treatment. You just do some soft tissue procedure on the Achilles tendon and you will fix it then in a cast.
How much do you think?
And this is an amount of maybe $15 to $20.
$20?
Yeah, and that's all. So not all is super expensive. Mm. So even small money is helping and will change life.
Excellent. When is your next trip, doctor?
My next trip is on the 10th of December.
Okay.
And we will come back before the Christmas.
I'm really inspired and in awe of the story that you have given us, doctor. I believe that this story deserves to go out into the world. And the objective of this podcast and this episode specifically is to tell you what has been happening on ground in Ghana and your stories. I wanted to go out. And the real objective is to try to raise funds to help you in the further missions. And I wish to render the support of our Rotary family here in Dubai and internationally and bring on more stakeholders. Thank you so much for your time, Dr. Andreas. It's been a privilege and a pleasure. We will have good news soon for this project. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, David.
Bless you, doctor. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.